Morning, everyone, and a very warm welcome to the 13th meeting of the Constitution Europe External Affairs and Culture Committee in 2022. Our first agenda item today is an update on the Parliamentary Partnership Assembly, which myself and the Deputy Convener attended last week in Brussels. This was the first meeting of the Assembly. It was very much a scene-setting agenda and deciding a way forward and future topics that could come up. There is a paper that has been a note of the meeting prepared by the clerks, which will be distributed to the members and published on the website. So I'm not spending too much time on this, but I think it's safe to say that the areas covered, there was a very good debate on the Friday afternoon on the Ukraine and a lot of consensus across Europe about the work that's been done by both the UK and the European Union in that respect. Also a very interesting discussion on energy cooperation and energy security going forward. On the first day, I have to say though that I think what was absolutely clear, and I'm going to invite Donald to say a few words as well, is the complete impasse there was between the UK and Europe in terms of the Northern Irish Protocol at that time. And I guess my observation was that it absolutely dominated the 2 days, and what was really disappointing was there wasn't a Northern Irish voice in the room. And even if colleagues from the Welsh Senate were represented as observers as well, if our colleagues had been there, they wouldn't have had speaking rights at it, and so everybody was talking about them, but very little actual experience from the people that were being talked about. So, but very interesting, and looking forward to seeing how it develops going forward. I'll just invite Donald to say a few words.
Thank you, Convener. Not much to add, to reinforce what you said about the events, certainly on the first day being overshadowed by the dispute around the Northern Ireland Protocol, which was a great shame, I think. But it was good to be there in person and to be in the same room as delegates from both UK Parliament and the European Parliament. There were some practical suggestions about how things might develop thereafter, rather than just there being a general discussion. So there was talk about working groups being set up to look at specific policy areas, which I think would, from my point of view, would be a good thing. And as the convener said, two very good sessions, one on EU-UK cooperation in terms of defence and intelligence when it came to Ukraine, and then another excellent session on energy and cooperation, particularly around things like new energy technologies. So all in all, it was a worthwhile and fascinating visit.
Thank you very much. As I said, that will be published on the website for anyone who's got an interest in committee members will have an opportunity to read that. Our second agenda item today, and could I welcome to committee, first of all, our colleague from the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee, Convener Stuart McMillan, who's an interest in what we're doing today. A very warm welcome to you. And our second agenda item is on evidence from a roundtable format on legislative consent after Brexit. This is the first of a series of round tables we have planned on post-EU constitutional issues. And I'm delighted to be joined by this morning by Professor Nicola McEwen, Professor of Territorial Politics from the University of Edinburgh and Senior Research Fellow, UK and Changing Europe. Morning. Professor Stephen Tierney, Professor of Constitutional Theory at the University of Edinburgh. Professor Aileen McCarg, Professor of Public Law and Human Rights from Durham University, and Akash Pond, Senior Fellow of the Institute of Government, and Professor Alan Page, Emeritus Professor of Public Law at the University of Dundee. And also online, so this is my first time managing a hybrid roundtable, so bear with me, people. But Michael Clancy, Director of Law Reform, the Law Society of Scotland, and who's online with us this morning. So our committee advisor, Dr. Christopher McCorkindale, who's a senior lecturer in law at the University of Strathclyde, is also here. And I'm going to invite, we have four topics this morning. As always, I'm afraid that we have to have a sharp close because of FMQs on a Thursday morning, but we're hoping to have a discussion of around 20 minutes on the four topics, and I'm going to invite Dr. McCorkindale to introduce each of those.
So the four topics that the committee has identified of particular interest are, first of all, what is the constitutional purpose of the convention, of the Sewell Convention, and what principles and values underpin its proper operation? So I suppose underpinning this is that, as some of the evidence has highlighted, until roughly 2016, until the Brexit process, the convention operated largely uncontroversially. And one of the aspects of that is that, on the one hand, it got the business of government and legislation done, but on the other hand, it meant that some of the key principles and values and meanings that underpin the convention never had to be stress tested. They never had to be unpacked. And now we're in a stressful situation and we're finding that there's lots of conflict and contestation around these things when we need them most. So some of the issues that might be covered in this 20-minute discussion, the first 20-minute discussion, or has there been a shift in the purpose of Sewell from protecting devolved autonomy and facilitating shared governance towards the articulation and continuation of conflict? Can Sewell meaningfully protect devolved autonomy and meaningfully facilitate shared governance, particularly given its nature as a political rule? And following Miller in the Supreme Court, can the imbalance of political power between the UK and devolved be redressed by a political as opposed to a legal and justiciable rule? We'll then go on to discuss different issues. What is the meaning of consent in the context of the Sewell Convention, which might include whether there is a shared meaning of consent across political actors, whether that meaning is consistent across the proliferating consent requirements, and to what extent is the meaning evolving, particularly through the Brexit process. The third topic will be what constitutes a not normal context, such that the UK Parliament need not obtain devolved consent. This might include, is this a normative exception to the general rule, or is it a purely descriptive one? Is it enough to describe COVID or Brexit as not normal situations that therefore justify the override of consent on its facts? And then finally, to what extent has the behaviour of the Scottish Government and the UK Government towards consent impacted the legislative and scrutiny functions of this Parliament? To what extent is the trend in certain contexts to override the withholding of consent impacted the proper exercise of the Parliament's functions? To what extent has the Scottish Government's willingness to recommend consent impacted on the proper exercise of the Parliament's functions? And how significant, if at all, is the problem of consent as a means of post-Brexit constitutional regulation? Is this a fundamental shift in the application, or is it a particular response to the heat of the moment?
Thank you very much, Dr. McCorkindale. If those in the room could indicate to myself or the clerks, if you want to come in, we'll try to get everybody in time. And for those online, if they could put an R on a chart, it'll be really relayed to me by the clerks. I'm going to invite Mr. Ruskell to open questions from the committee.
Yeah, thanks, convener. Well, I wanted to pick up on that final topic, actually, because you know, I was thinking about the comments from yourself, Professor McEwen, about there being a sort of an age of former glory of use of the Sewell Convention, and obviously in very different political times, and as Chris has said, perhaps at a time when it wasn't being stress tested quite so much, but interested in parliamentary scrutiny and your thoughts around the table as to whether, you know, there's more parliamentary scrutiny. There was more parliamentary scrutiny in the past. Whether there's less parliamentary scrutiny today, and what the opportunities for parliamentary scrutiny might be going forward. So, yeah, Professor Page is nodding. So, you've invited yourself to make the first comment.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much. I think the first thing I would say is that it's possible to overanalyze the convention, to get too worked up about what it means. The essential point is that it's very careful not to exclude the possibility of legislation in devolved areas being made without the Parliament's consent. If it did that, then we wouldn't be talking about devolution, we'd be talking about federalism. And as has been said before Brexit, it was very difficult to imagine the UK Parliament legislating without the consent of the Scottish Parliament because of the political backlash that it would inevitably provoke. But with Brexit, as we've seen, that has become not common, but not uncommon. On the point about behaviour, I think another point to be borne in mind is that the Scottish Government, and by extension the Scottish Parliament, have always found it convenient to be able to rely on Westminster legislation, both primary and secondary, in the devolved areas. That was true before Brexit, it was true in the preparations for Brexit, and it will continue to be true in the future. So talk of power grabs and the like, I think, conceal a great deal by way of active cooperation. And that seems to have been true even of the less harmonious relations between the UK and Scottish governments in the preparations for Brexit. On a brief reading of the legislative memoranda in this session, quite a lot of them refer to changes in bills which have been made as a result of discussions between the UK and Scottish governments. And against that background, coming to the question you raised, the difficulty the Parliament faces and has always faced is effectively scrutinising lawmaking in the devolved areas other than by the Scottish Parliament and Scottish ministers. And that's always been a difficulty. It was a difficulty in the first decade of devolution. It took 10 years to get a procedure put in place whereby, you know, legislative consent memoranda and legislative consent motions are submitted to the Parliament. Before that, there was a great deal of uncertainty about what exactly was happening, what was the substance of these negotiations, who was saying what to who, and what were the results in terms of the legislation. Another example was Westminster legislation and implementation of EU obligations, secondary legislation. I remember thinking in 2007, there was absolutely no information about what was happening there. All we knew was that there was a presumption in favour of Scottish secondary legislation, but it was clear the Scottish Government continued to rely heavily on Westminster legislation in these areas. I thought, change of government, all that will change. Not a bit of it. There continued to be next to no information about what was actually happening, or there was a promise of information and then it was late and all the rest of it. So I agree with what Dr. McCorkindale said about the importance of the Parliament being vigilant to ensure that its role is not hollowed out. Yes, you can say in relation to primary legislation, but I would have said the real key is secondary legislation. And I would therefore endorse what I think Spice said in your briefing paper about the need to get that sorted out. The Statutory Instruments Protocol in its current form, the second version of it, is clearly incomplete. And that needs, I think, to be addressed. So
it's very useful.
Bring in Professor McEwen.
I'll leave it to my colleagues to talk about the secondary legislation aspect. I was thinking a little bit about Chris's point about stress testing, and I think I would agree with that description in the facility. Well, I think, Aileen, you made the really helpful distinction about defensive and facilitative aspects of the Seoul Convention. And I think in the case where the UK government was legislating in devolved matters with the consent of the Scottish Parliament and the Scottish government, then yes, I agree with that. It wasn't a particularly stressful thing. It's quite stressful on the defensive side, though, and I'm thinking of that sort of broader definition of Sewell around the one that's in the devolution guidance notes, which is about legislating with consent when it's about devolved powers, which is not a devolved matter, it's a reserved matter when you're legislating on the constitutional settlement. But the convention has, in its use, been broadened out to encompass securing consent before you change the powers of devolution. That was quite stressful sometimes. I remember sitting around this table for Scotland Act 2016. But it was also an illustration of where the Parliament and the government could use the convention to get significant leverage in shaping Westminster legislation on that occasion on a reserve matter. And I think actually, even though the EU Withdrawal Act was an incident to be repeated where the UK Parliament legislated without the consent of this Parliament, the process that led up to that, I think, still created the opportunities for influencing and changing that legislation, albeit not to the point at which the Parliament felt it could grant consent. I'm not sure we're in that place now. So I think, I worry that the opportunities for exercising that defensive aspect of SEWL have been diminished, in part because of the number of times that it has been tested and then not, or the sort of ambiguity around when it's normal and not normal circumstances, and I'm sure we'll come back to that. But also because for the SEWL Convention to work, it has to have a willingness on the part of both governments. It's essentially a legislative tool, but it's actually an intergovernmental process. There's an awful lot of intergovernmental interaction that takes place prior to the decision to grant or withhold consent. And if that isn't working, and if that isn't functioning effectively, then you have a problem. And I think we have a problem.
Thank you. Professor Tierney?
Thank you. I suppose I would begin by saying that, to agree with Alan, that we have to be careful about reifying the convention itself. I mean, conventions are a reflection of constitutional practice, and as constitutional practice changes, the nature of the convention changes. And this particular convention is a pragmatic solution to policing the borders of devolved competence to some extent. That's common in any territorialised system, federal system. And what you find in any system is some long-stop power that does lie with the centre. We see it in federal systems in supremacy clauses, in residual power clauses, in a right of preemption, whereby if the centre moves in a particular area, it occupies that territory and no one else can exercise it. I think the Scotland Act is actually a more progressive approach in that it doesn't explicitly authorise that power, and that power operates through this convention. And one of the reasons I think why there's such a stress on the convention in recent times is to some extent because of the expansion of devolved power. We see this in 2012 and 2016, and now in some sense through Brexit with the return of powers. And what we've found is that whereas the Scotland Act demarcated quite carefully the different areas in which devolved and central government operated, there are now many areas where there's a lot more shared competence. We see it in cross-border transactions through internal market. We're seeing it in the current procurement bill. So there are many areas where there is a need for far closer cooperation in how to operate powers that are now much more clearly shared. And I think this is a real challenge for parliaments, to return to the question. First of all, to identify just where those limits are now in terms of all, and also in terms of managing the vast swathe of legislation that's coming out of Westminster post-Brexit, just as a practical matter. And also fundamentally the fact that so much of this legislation is now secondary. And I think the big gap really is that the SEWL Convention doesn't apply to delegated powers, and because of the extent to which EU law is now being repealed, it was introduced through secondary legislation, it's been repealed through secondary, or revoked through secondary legislation, this is where the real gap is. And it seems to me that we maybe take our eye off the ball if we focus too much on this convention, when the solutions have to be intergovernmental at the executive level, and in particular interparliamentary, I think, in terms of better timing, more heads up, more stages in the process whereby amendments can be brought forward. I'm sure we'll come back to all of that. But I think we need to see the convention in a much broader context of the nature of devolution, where the residue power does lie with the Scottish with the Scottish Parliament, and also in terms of just the pragmatics of far more shared powers post-Brexit.
Can I bring in Professor? I'll bring in a second, Mr. Bonnet. I'm going to bring in Professor McCarthy first. Thanks.
Thank you. So just wanted to agree with some of the things that have already been said, but make a few additional comments. So in terms of we talked about the constitutional function of the convention. I think what Brexit has revealed is the limits of its ability to manage shared rule. So where we're talking about sort of standard policy issues, it seems to cope fairly well. But what was distinct about Brexit is it's a change to the constitutional framework. It has impacts on devolution, yes, of course, very important impacts on devolution. But it has impacts for the whole of the UK. And it's on those aspects of the shared constitutional framework that I think we've really seen the limitations of the convention. Now, I said in my briefing, I think there are lots of different kinds of questions which were thrown up in the Brexit process. And on some respects, it was, you know, I think it was legitimate, acceptable to operate without devolved consent. I think in other respects, not. And we need to be quite nuanced and careful about how we approach these issues. On process, I think I would agree that the major issues are around secondary legislation. On primary legislation, there are good processes which operate in this parliament and other devolved parliaments. Of course, these are often constrained by time, but that's a feature of the legislative process in general and difficult to cope with. Secondary legislation is really problematic. There are no general principles in play here. It's very ad hoc, the mechanisms that have developed. I would say, though, I think there are different issues of principle that apply to secondary legislation compared to primary legislation, because ministers are not the same. The UK ministers are not the same as the UK Parliament. They're not in the same constitutional position. So whereas, you know, Stephen says in any federal system, you have a long stop position for the centre, and we have that in the form of parliamentary sovereignty. That is not the same as saying, well, it's fine for there to be a residual right for UK ministers to act in devolved areas. That raises very different issues, I think. And then the final point I wanted to make on process is, of course, it's not just a matter of process in this parliament, but there's also big questions about process in the UK parliament. And I think that is where there are really, really significant gaps. And I know the Institute for Government has made some good suggestions in that area. Thanks.
Very neatly bringing in on that point, Akash Bond. Thanks.
Thanks very much. And thanks for the invitation. Nice to be back in the Scottish Parliament for the first time in over 2 years, I think. To go back to the question of the purpose of the sewer convention, I also think the distinction between the core constitutional purpose of protecting the political autonomy of the devolved institutions, and then its maybe more practical purpose of facilitating cooperation and ensuring there's a common standard of law in certain areas where there's political agreement. I think that's quite a useful distinction to draw. As far as the sort of defensive purpose, as Professor McCarg has put it, is concerned, of course, it was always known that the convention was framed in such terms as to mean that it wasn't judiciable, there was potential for exceptions in not normal circumstances, and so on. Parliamentary sovereignty was retained. Everybody knew that all along. However, I think it is hard to look back sometimes and remember how much perceptions of it have changed. I mean, I think prior to Brexit, sure, parliamentary sovereignty was intact and all the rest of it, but the Sewell Convention was seen by a lot of people as being close to a veto, not a legal veto, but more or less being an inviolable convention. There's a political and constitutional reform committee report that the committee might have seen from 2015 that was looking at the Scotland Bill, or 1516 maybe, that the Scotland Bill as it was going through, that concluded that the way that Sewell was put into statute was legally vacuous, as they put it, and that was obviously sort of proved to be the case when Miller looked at it. However, they also said that hardly anyone can envisage a circumstance when Westminster would legislate without, would deliberately legislate without consent. And I think that was the view at the time, and it's reflected in the fact that from what I can recall anyway, I mean, the Scottish government in the negotiations over the Scotland Bill didn't really put up much of a fight on the way that Sewell was written into the bill. I mean, the focus was on the fiscal powers, the surrounding fiscal framework and so on. That's what most of the attention was placed upon. People thought that, you know, the Sewell Convention worked, basically, and it did. So it has been a big shift. I do think it's very significant. I mean, people have talked about the ways that that have happened. I think if you go back to the passage of the original, the EU Withdrawal Bill, Withdrawal Act, in 2018, I think it's quite clear that the UK government really, really didn't want to breach the Sewell Convention. There were, as Professor McEwen mentioned, lots of amendments made to address concerns of the Scottish government. Consent was secured from Wales. That was seen as a really big thing from the UK government perspective. They really didn't want it to end with an open breach of the convention. But I think having done it that once and the sky didn't fall in from a Whitehall perspective, it's made it much easier for them to then justify it publicly and maybe to themselves as well on a series of subsequent occasions. And now, you know, we've seen really the commitment to it, I think, really watered down, and the government talking about it much more, as some of the papers note, in terms of a good, you know, good practice, a nicety, a courtesy, rather than actually some kind of obligation.
Thank you. Mr. Clancy, online, thanks.
Thank you very much indeed, Convener, and good morning, everyone. So there's so much in all of this, and we've had so many diverse comments. But can I just pick up on a couple or so, because I know we're well over 20 minutes on this section. The first thing was that I was present in the House of Lords on that day in July 1998 in the opposition advisers box when Lord Sewell made the declaration that has become associated with his name. But of course, even in the context of that declaration, he acknowledged that there had been preceding precedent for such an arrangement in Northern Ireland. And I think it might be instructive at some point to look closely at the experience in Northern Ireland of the Northern Ireland Parliament from 1921 through to the 70s, and I happen to have come across a comment about a Treasury document for official use, which it stated that in practice the UK Parliament refrained from legislating on matters with which Northern Ireland Parliament can deal, except at the request and with the consent of Northern Ireland, and it is recognised that any departure from this practice would be open to objection as impairing the responsibility which has been placed on the Northern Ireland Parliament and Northern Ireland Government. I think that that's an interesting take on the convention, is that it's about this balancing of sovereignty and the restraints on its exercise by the sovereign legislative power, where the devolved legislature has been invested with making power and responsibility in defined areas, and has a democratic basis for doing so. So I think that if we look at this in a more contextualised way, we can see this cropping up, of course, in imperial law and The case which is referred to in Miller of Madzimbuto v. Lardner-Burke about the Rhodesian Parliament. But when we get to the point which I think was expressed by Professor McEwen about the intergovernmental relations aspect, Miller, of course, tells us that the application of the Convention was adopted, they say, as a means of establishing cooperative relationships between the UK Parliament and the devolved institutions. So following Dr. McCorkindale's call to get back to basics on this, that might be where we have to readdress matters, that in the context of intergovernmental relations, the issue of ensuring that there is a cooperative relationship in the relating to the consent by the Scottish Parliament and the other devolved legislatures is important. Looking then at the 2016 Scotland Bill, when it was passing through Parliament, I was also there, but and again in the opposition advisers' box, the whole concept of the Sewell Convention was narrowed down to that which was represented by Lord Sewell in July 1998. The additional aspects, which we find in Devolution Guidance Note 10, about the impact on legislative competence of the Parliament and executive competence of Scottish ministers, were staunchly objected to in terms of being incorporated into the bill by the Advocate General on behalf of the government, the UK government. And I think anyone who was there and active and involved in analysing the bill, and most of the people around this table were, would be able to tell you that it was almost entirely predictable that the government of the day then was interpreting the Sewell Convention in a narrow way, which would then mean that issues about competence of the Parliament, competence of ministers, could be put to one side because they weren't even referenced in the declaration in the Scotland Act 1998, which came out of the 2016 bill.
Thank you very much, Mr. Clancy. And I think sticking to 20 minutes for each of the topics, we've already had quite a fluid mix of all four. So I'm quite relaxed about that going forward. But I do have a number of members who want to contribute. So what I'm going to do is take contributions from Alistair Allen and Donald Cameron and then go back to the wider group and then bring other people in later on. So Dr. Allen.
Thank you, Convener. I'm glad to hear that you're relaxed about us wandering from subject to subject. in which case, I just wonder if people watching, if there are any people watching, are curious, as I think a lot of people are, about the extent to which constitutional practice does rest on things called conventions. And I'm conscious that word is used in different ways. But I'm interested to know, perhaps from Professor McEwen, perhaps from Professor Tierney, since they're both sitting next to me, about where the Sewell Convention sits in that food chain or that hierarchy, if there is one, of conventions. I mean, at one end seems to sit conventions that haven't been challenged for a long time, like the convention that the Queen has to appoint a Prime Minister who has some support in the House of Commons. At the other end, you have conventions like this one, which the Supreme Court seemed to characterise as a political convention. So, where does Sewell sit in that hierarchy for those of us, myself included, who find the whole idea of the British Constitution mysterious and sometimes offensive?
Mr. Cameron, please.
Someone who doesn't find the British Constitution offensive. I think Alistair makes a good point. I think there is a wider question about the utility of conventions, not just Sewell, and I'd be fascinated to know what our witnesses think about that. I mean, I was quite struck by something that Professor Page said, and this is perhaps a contrarian view, but are we in danger of overstating the problem here? Undoubtedly, we've had some very high-profile examples of the convention under strain
particularly around Brexit. But day in, day out, when the when we're seeing the LCMs here in Parliament, mostly on secondary legislation, it is relatively uncontroversial. In fact, we've they go through Parliament quite almost without a vote, and they've been agreed between the Scottish Government and the UK Government. And it's just as a matter of administrative practicality in everyone's interest for that to happen. So I just would put that to our witnesses. And lastly, this is really a question for the lawyers in the room. But we've had some recent decisions, particularly in the UNCRC case, where the courts have quite sort of firmly taken the view, they've restated Section 28.7 of the Scotland Act in terms of the UK government's ability to legislate for Scotland, I think it says. And I just wonder if that has a bearing, it's not directly on Sewell, but I wonder if that has a bearing on at least the court's view of these various issues.
Thank you. I'm going to bring in order Professor McEwen, Professor Tierney, Professor Page, as well mentioned by my colleagues, and then open it up for wider contributions. So, Professor McEwen.
Yeah, I'm going to let Stephen deal with the point about the where the convention sits. But I mean, I think if we were talking about the uncontroversial and technical and facility to function, then yes, we would be overstating a problem. But I think the Sewell Convention would be hollowed out considerably if we only thought it, if it only worked when nobody disagreed. So if you're talking about a problem where you reduce something to a technical exercise, or there's no controversy anyway, and it becomes an efficient tool for doing things, which is an important aspect of it, and if that's continuing to work, that's fine. The problem emerges when there is a matter of controversy and there is a matter of disagreement and there is a difference for whatever reason. It could be political reasons, it could be institutional reasons, it could be stakeholder divergences or whatever, where there is a desire to do something differently. And I think what's coming up at the moment is it's more difficult to find the compromises that would enable something to be done on a UK-wide basis, where that might be desirable to do something on a UK-wide basis. Sewell doesn't really work if the only way you can do that is if everyone falls into line. I was aware of an issue around, and I don't know the details of the bill, but what seems on the face of it to be a relatively uncontroversial thing around cultural objects that you would have dealt with. Mm-hmm. And in the case of the Senedd, I know that there was an issue there where they wanted it to be done on a UK-wide basis, but they had a problem with a particular aspect and struggled to get the kind of agreement in the intergovernmental space that would have enabled that to happen. So that's why I stressed earlier about the need, and Michael also talked about the need to also look at the intergovernmental space where these sorts of decisions would be taking place. Now, when you do look at that space, obviously that raises issues for Parliament, because that tends to be a closed space that isn't as subject to scrutiny as it could and should be, arguably. So it's I think helpful when we're thinking about Sewell and its development to think about the different functionality of it. And sometimes, yes, it is a problem, and sometimes less so.
Yes, to answer Alistair's question, very interesting question about I think the first point there is on the nature of a convention. So we quite, the court in the Miller case said, this is just a political restriction, therefore we're not going to touch it. That, I think, underestimates what a convention is. A convention is a rule. It might be a political rule, but it is binding. And the court could have gone further there and said, yes, we can't enforce this convention, but what we can do is say it exists, we can articulate its content, and we can declare it's been breached. The court didn't go those steps, but the Supreme Court in Canada has done that in the past, and that's an option open to court. And that puts enormous political pressure on the centre not to proceed. It forced Pierre Trudeau to completely rethink how he was changing the constitution by the Supreme Court doing that in 1982 in Canada. The other question you raise is about, is this more important than other conventions? I think it's a very interesting question. I think the problem is it's so wide-ranging that if SEWL is violated in relation to a public emergency in a very narrow area, a lot of people would sit back and say, well, actually, you know, that's fine. Whereas if SEWL were to be used to completely rewrite the Scotland Act then one would imagine that that convention would, the violation of that would be seen as equivalent to violating the Convention of Royal Assent to legislation. The problem is it's such a wide-ranging convention, so I think it really depends what the subject matter would be. On the rights of the child, because I think it's a very interesting point, and the Supreme Court was unusually inflammatory and critical of that piece of legislation, suggesting that at least one section took no count of the limits of legislative competence as a matter of policy. Now, I don't want to get into whether that's the case or not, but that's inflammatory language from the Supreme Court. What I would say, and I think this is the way I was talking about earlier, is that we're now in the realm of so many shared powers that the issue really is one now of intergovernmental and interparliamentary relations, and possibly to review from both sides whether they're stepping into reserved or devolved competence, possibly inadvertently, possibly self-consciously. But I think there's a debate to be had in both directions about violations of legal competence or convention, respectively.
Thank you. Very briefly, yes.
Just on that, I mean, I think it's a very interesting point, because I think actually this often here becomes an argument about is it reserved or is it devolved? And we had an LCM in the chamber where on the Nationality and Borders Bill, where the UK government's position was the consent isn't required because it doesn't touch on devolved areas. The Scottish government's position was, well, in practice it does. And there was an argument and a vote about that here. And I think often, as you said, this is actually not just about the application of the convention, but an argument about where the limits sit. Thanks.
Thanks. Professor Page.
Thank you. In terms of the status of the convention, or what is a convention, yes, it's more than just a statement of practice. It is a rule. I think of it, well, in this context, I think of it in terms of degrees of bindingness. And if we go back to the Scotland Act 2016, writing it into the devolution settlement, you could have said, or at least I thought at the time, this was setting the seal on federal, quasi-federal relationship between Scotland and the United Kingdom, in which it would be inconceivable that the UK Parliament would legislate without the consent of the Scottish Parliament. And Michael Clancy, in his evidence earlier on, captured that perfectly when he described the Treasury's summary of the position in Northern Ireland it's unthinkable, we simply wouldn't do that. I'm not sure, given what was actually happening in Northern Ireland, that was a particularly admirable position for the UK government to adopt. Nothing to do with us. You know, they can get on with it and do what they like, with the consequences that we saw. So you could have said it was on the point of crystallising, becoming a hard, binding rule at that point. And what's happened since is it's just become fluid. It's like there's been an earthquake and the ground suddenly becomes molten, which is why we're sitting here talking about, well, how binding is it now? And I would say it certainly hasn't lost some of its force, but it has hasn't lost all of its force, but lost some of its force.
I'm going to bring in Professor McCarg, Dr. McCorkindale, and then Mr. Clancy again. Thanks.
Thank you. On Dr. Allen's question, that really was an excellent question, and please come along to my tutorials. in terms of how you determine its place in the kind of hierarchy of conventions, I think there's maybe three dimensions you want to look at in terms of the importance of conventions. So the first one would be age. Now, this is obviously not the oldest of conventions, but as we heard from Michael Clancy, it does have a prehistory that makes it older than you might think. But age in itself doesn't protect against controversy. I mean, the convention that the Queen always grants royal assent became contested during the Brexit process extraordinarily. But that would have been something you would what I would have said was absolutely beyond doubt, but it was questioned by people who had an interest in questioning it. Clarity is a second dimension. And Sewell is, of course, relatively clear as conventions go because it is written down. It's in the Scotland Act, it's in the Wales Act, it's amplified in devolution guidance notes, etc. So that makes it clearer than some conventions and maybe not as clear as others. But I think the third important dimension and the one that's really problematic for Sewell is, if you like, the political and institutional context in which it operates. So the other area in which conventions are very, very important is around about the existence and accountability of the UK government, the idea that the UK government is drawn from and accountable to the Westminster Parliament. Now, there's all sorts of problems about the operation of that in practice, but it is a convention that is not seriously contested, I think, partly because it operates in a context in which there is reciprocity or a mutual interest in seeing that convention operate effectively. So both government and opposition have a mutual interest, because they might switch places, in seeing that that convention operates properly. The Sewell Convention is not like that, because you're talking about a relationship between the UK institutions and the devolved institutions in which there isn't that reciprocity. They don't switch places. So they're very much on, when contests arises, they're on opposite sides of a dispute rather than in a position where greater consensus over its meaning an operation might be achieved. So I think that is important for Sewell. On the UNCRC reference point, so 2 points to make there. And I think the issue with the way in which the Supreme Court has used Section 28.7, it's not about its reassertion that parliamentary sovereignty still exists. We all knew that. It's the content that the Supreme Court has given to parliamentary sovereignty in its incarnation in Section 28.7, and it's given it a very extended meaning, such that mere pressure on the UK Parliament is now understood as compromising sovereignty, which, you know, is wholly unorthodox. And, you know, if you go back to Dicey would have made a strong distinction between political constraints on legislative competence, on the UK Parliament's competence, and legal constraints, and political constraints didn't count. I mean, that's how I've taught parliamentary sovereignty for decades now. The other point to make about the UNCRC reference is, I think it does have a very direct implication for what this Parliament does in relation to the granting of legislative consent, because what it told us was that when you're legislating for things like the UNCRC bill and you want to create framework legislation that captures everything within the devolved sphere, it does not attach, you cannot attach that to UK legislation. So if you want things like the UNCRC or other international treaties to attach to lawmaking in the devolved sphere, that is going to have to be lawmaking from this Parliament or from the Scottish ministers.
Thank you. Dr.
McCorkydale? Yeah, I just wanted to come in quickly on what Donald had said about the, things basically operate fine, and there are exceptional cases, and we're maybe overclaiming or being drawn disproportionately to those. But there's been some interesting developments. The Welsh Committee of the Welsh Assembly has recently looked at that, or Welsh Parliament, sorry, has looked at this. A committee of the Northern Irish Assembly has been looking at this. And amongst these heated debates, they've also highlighted that when things become too efficient and too effective, and it's too easy just to consent, then actually the legislator's function is cut out. So the Welsh Assembly, the Welsh Parliament has been looking at issues like the kept animals legislation, and, you know, saying, well, there are matters of great public interest here, and it might be convenient for the UK Parliament to legislate for all sorts of reasons, but this is an area that we should be scrutinising and debating. The Northern Irish Assembly is greatly concerned about UK Parliament legislation in devolved areas where ministers don't notify the Assembly at all that the legislation has passed, and so Parliament, the Assembly is operating blind. So there's an extent to which it can be, we can overclaim for the efficiency of it, and we have to actually be vigilant when things are happening on an efficient basis, because we might be missing where actually there are important areas of policy that ought to be given a second look or a first look by this Parliament.
Mr. Clancy.
Thank you, Convener. The very interesting analysis which Professor McHarg gave us about age and clarity and so on, when one is looking at the Seoul Convention, of course, yes, it's not that old, although if one reaches back into legislation connected to the Empire and even to dependencies, crown dependencies, such as the Channel Islands, you find it cropping up in various guises along the way. But clarity, I think, is one of the key points, and that's where the use of normality comes in, and we'll come to that later. But there certainly was considerable debate about whether the convention as enunciated by Lord Sewell was clear enough to be put into a statute with the existence of the continued reference to normality. Stephen Tierney made an interesting point about the Canadian example, and of course that too was referenced in Miller. And I think there's an interesting quote from the Chief Justice there: the very nature of a convention as political in inception. So that's the starting point. I think we've got to remember that constitutional conventions are political as tools for smoothing the way in organising the constitution and making life a bit easier for everyone. And as depending on a consistent course of political recognition, that's another condition, that it's recognised by those who are operating it in the political arena. The convention developed over a considerable period of time, but that recognition is inconsistent with legal enforcement. And I think that's another leg to what a convention is all about, is that it's not capable of being taken to court forced upon one of the parties. It is meant to be some kind of organic, proto-legal issue, a political issue, which doesn't easily sit with being enforced by the courts. And I think that these are the things which one would think about, and I would be very hesitant about creating in my own mind a hierarchy of conventions. I think that would lead to far too many internal squabbles if we were to say my convention is better, older, faster, stronger than yours. I think it's important that we look on the concept of constitutional convention as being a necessary one, because when we start to try to bring them into law, it creates some of the difficulties that we see with the Sewell Convention, but there are other conventions which have been brought into law, and most recently the conventions regarding prorogation, which were abandoned with the Fixed Term Parliaments Act, have been, in inverted commas, revived, close inverted commas, by the Dissolution and Calling of Parliament Bill. I think it might be an act now. And yet, it's a different creature because it's no longer a constitutional convention. It's now a legal statement in an Act of Parliament.
Thank you. Mr. Pond.
Thanks very much. There's been already some, I think, really useful discussion of what is a convention, how do we define one and so on. I mean, I was in answer to the original question on that point. Approach would be to go back to the classic definition of a constitutional convention of either Jennings, and he said well, what are the three tests of a convention? Is there a clear purpose for it? Is it based on established precedent? And do the relevant actors involved see themselves, feel themselves to be bound by the convention? And I mean, in the case of Sewell, again, going back to the pre-Brexit and the post-Brexit context, I think it's, you know, I would argue it was very well established as a strong convention. I don't know exactly where one would place it in a hierarchy, that's difficult to do, but on all of those three tests, I mean, we've talked quite a bit about the purpose of it, and for me that goes back to we needed the consent convention in order to, as the Supreme Court put it in the Imperial Tobacco case, I think, to help create a system for the exercise of legislative power that was coherent, stable, and workable. That was not a point made in reference to Sewell, but a point made by the Supreme Court about how devolution was intended to work. And I think Sewell was a kind of core pillar of that. In terms of precedent and practice, I mean, Michael Clancy's talked quite a lot about even the pre-1999 precedents going way back into history of relations with Stormont and Dominion parliaments and so on. And then even post-1999, it had been used a couple of hundred times, I think, by the point of Brexit. And then on the question of whether actors see themselves as bound by it, well, I do think the government absolutely did, to a large extent, pre-Brexit. What's the situation now is really the key question. And I think there's countervailing dynamics in terms of the views on that, you know, on that question within Whitehall and Westminster. There are, I think, some people, including ministers, who are really trying to limit the breaches to the convention as much as possible, limit, you know, in particular to things seen as inevitable, necessary consequences of Brexit. But that seems to be getting broadened into legislation that, you know, is by no means an absolute necessity to make Brexit work. And there's also very much a kind of shift in political strategy, I think, coming from the top, in terms of a much more expansive view of what the role of the UK government should be in terms of action and visibility in the devolved nations. And we can see that in particular, I think, through the Internal Market Act, the financial assistance powers established through that, and the way that ministers are now really starting to get involved in what were hitherto seen as devolved areas.
Thank you. Dr. Allen, did you want to come in briefly?
Yeah. So just on that point, thank you, convener. Yeah, I was just interested in the point you made there about a sense of movement away from things that might be needed to cope with a Brexit urgent situation. And I saw in written evidence, Professor McEwen, you talked about, I think, a similar point. You were talking about how initially the not normal reasoning was used around the Brexit deal because it was an urgent, emergent situation. But you drew a contrast between that, I see in your evidence, between things like the Internal Market Act, Professional Qualifications Act, Subsidy Control Act. So I just wondered if either of you had a view on whether there's a contrast to be made between urgent situations, emergent situations, and pieces of legislation that don't meet that requirement, in your view, when it comes to using this phrase, not normal.
Yes, I think Aileen made the same point in her evidence as well. Yes, but even then, I think it's difficult for me to conceive of a situation where there is clarity on what's not normal or what's exceptional and unique and urgent without even prior consent about that. So you can imagine, say, COVID might have been the perfect example where normal practice was set aside. In some ways, in many ways, normal practice was set aside, but still functioned there. Mm-hmm. And there was consent for UK-wide legislation. And so, but that was with agreement. So the problem for me comes in when you decide after the fact that something is so abnormal or so exceptional as to not require consent after it has been sought. So that it seems to me that you almost need agreement prior to that process between the governments that this is an unusual or so exceptional circumstance that we can set aside our normal practice or convention. And it's difficult to see in the current environment how you get to that point.
Thank you. I'm conscious of time. I want to suspend for 5 minutes, very strictly, just for a comfort break. And we come back, I want to bring in both Ms. Boyack and Mr. McMillan. Can I welcome everyone back and can I invite questions, comments from Ms Boyack and Mr McMillan, and then we'll open up the discussion again.
Thanks very much. Can I just formally say thanks for all the paperwork we've had in advance of this, because it's really useful to get the different perspectives. Even when you're actually saying similar things, it's still just good going through both the high-level issues that you've raised and then the detail. The issues I was quite keen on following up were, what do we do about this? And you can actually, even in the last hour, detect from members of the committee difference in emphasis and thoughts. But if you go back to the point that I think Professor McHarg made about the age of the convention, the issue of clarity, what do we mean by normality, and then the whole issue of political consent, that there's something, and context, there's something about, okay, lessons learned, 99 to 2022 with the 2016 legislation. What do we think now as a parliament? So I'm very interested in the two sets of recommendations we've got from Professor McHarg and the Institute for Government on what would be your potential solutions, what would be the potential change. And I would quite like to kick off with the fact that there's an issue about accountability, which was clearly not designed in by Sewell, which is at the UK level, ministers can initiate a piece of legislation and not be accountable at the UK level. There's no structure there. So there's something about how do we hold the Scottish Government to account on secondary legislation? How is the UK Government held to account on secondary legislation? But at a higher level, in terms of primary legislation, there's no accountability there. And I'd like to start off on that discussion, because I both Institute for Government and Professor McHarg, you've both got some really good, clear recommendations. I was wondering if you'd just give us a quick summary on high level and some practical changes.
And Mr McMillan, could you bring your question in?
Thank you. Thank you, convener. So the question's mostly for Michael Clancy. I was a member of the Devolution for the Powers Committee way back, and some of this discussion and dialogue is taking place. It's taking me back to 2015 and then up to 2016. And the issue of Sewell was something that the committee discussed at great length. And I know that the Law Society had proposed amendments to the bill with the suggestion to actually remove the word normally from section 28.8, which is obviously in the Act. So certainly a question to Mr Clancy would be, if the amendments as proposed by the Law Society actually were accepted at that point, does he think that we would be having this type of discussion in this committee today? And also, does he think that the situation between the two parliaments, the two governments, would actually be on a better footing as compared to where they currently are? Thank you.
I think I'm going to go to Mr Clancy first for that very specific question, and then I'll bring in Professor McHarg, Mr Pone, and perhaps Professor Tierney, if you could reflect on your statements about other federal arrangements and where gets this right, and who might have actually solved some of the questions we're asking about, and then I'll open it up. So Mr Clancy, first of all, please.
Thank you, convener, and thank you, Mr McMillan, for such an interesting question and for giving me zero time to prepare for it, but that's another matter. I think it's fair to say that one of the reasons why the Law Society sometimes promotes amendments is to ensure that the minister of the day can give an interpretation of an ambiguous provision in a bill which will satisfy the requirements of the case of Pepper v Hart, and will then mean that the parliamentary record could be referred to should that matter ever come into litigation. That is one of the reasons why we would promote an amendment. And partially that was the impetus for putting forward amendments to the 2015 bill, because of course the government the government had a majority in Parliament and would be able to achieve its intentions in getting the bill to the statute book. That having been said, there was a debate, a considerable debate, in the House of Lords, particularly on the question of normally, and what did it mean? Lord Lang of Monckton referred to it as special circumstances. Lord Cormac referred to it as that it should refer to times of war or national emergency. Lord McCluskey was in his best tradition of being someone who pointed out things with that twinkle in his eye. He was able to say that normally means usually, but norm means a standard, and the main definition in some dictionaries is of conforming to a standard. But it was quite clear that the government was having none of it, and the Advocate General was very gracious to Lord McCluskey to say that he did not accept the proposition that it would be for the court to say that Parliament decides whether it is normal to legislate for Scotland on a devolved matter. Instead, normally it means just that, no more or less. It is for the courts to say we don't think the situation it's not for the courts to say we don't think the situation was abnormal. That is a political decision, and of course that is the nub of dealing with normally. It's the creation of a political nexus in the convention about what is determined to be normal or not. If we removed normal from the terms of the Scotland Act, section 28(8), then it would be the case that it would that Westminster would not legislate with regard to devolved matters in Scotland without the consent of the Scottish Parliament. That would be quite an absolute provision, and I'm not going to comment on the political implications of that, because of course that's not my role, I'm not a politician, but I think the important thing is that having an absolute protection for the Scottish Parliament in these circumstances to prevent the UK Parliament from legislating under any circumstance could be problematic, and some of those we've talked about around the table today. We've talked about Brexit as being an exceptional set of circumstances, which in legislative terms were certainly not normal, possibly the biggest, most intensive reorganisation of legislative competence the UK has seen, with legislative and policy arrangements with so many bills on so many issues. We've also touched on COVID as being a not normal situation. And of course, we know that for the Coronavirus Act 2020, the four governments were in a deep conversation prior to the bill being introduced into the UK Parliament. And it went through in a very speedy time without any issues being raised about consent to the matter being legitimate or not. So I don't know if that actually answers your question, but you can see where we're leading. Having something which would take account of exceptional circumstances, not normal situations, it is, I think, quite important to have that in the legislation.
Thank you, Professor McCard.
Thank you. I mean, I'll just pick up briefly on what Michael said before I come on to the specific recommendations that I made, because they are linked. So, I mean, Michael is right to say that that not normally is clearly non-justiciable. It's something to be determined in the political sphere, but that doesn't mean to say it has to remain completely vague and undefined. I mean, Michael referred earlier to the dissolution principles that are attached to the Dissolution and Calling of Parliament Act. That's a political mechanism with a statutory underpinning, but it's trying to concretise conventions that previously existed there. So it is possible through non-statutory, non-legally binding mechanisms to try to clarify what we mean. The ministerial code, Scottish ministerial code, are also further examples of that kind of mechanism. So, in fact, the first of the four recommendations for reform that I made was some kind of statement from both UK and devolved governments, an agreed statement, first as to the bindingness of the Sewell Convention and what they understand it to mean, but also, to the extent possible, and not in excessive detail, of course, some kind of indication as to, or unpacking of when it might be justifiable constitutionally to make an exception. And I would think that both parliaments would want to be involved in scrutinising and endorsing that. The second thing that I think is important but difficult to achieve is some kind of mechanism for settling disputes about when the convention is engaged, because we've got these two sets of problems. Is devolved consent required at all? Does a bill or provisions in a bill relate to a devolved matter in some sense? And then once you've decided that it does, there is that second question of, well, if we can't achieve consent, can we proceed anyway? And we don't have any mechanism for resolving those disputes about whether the convention is engaged at all. That is what the Lord Advocate was asking the Supreme Court to do in the first Miller case. And as Stephen said, the Supreme Court just said, no, we're not going to get involved in that. And I think they could have done if they'd wanted to. I think that it's understandable in the particular context of that case why they didn't, but I think it is regrettable that they didn't, because it's very, very hard to try to replicate some kind of independent, impartial, authoritative mechanism for resolving those kind of disputes. Probably the best thing that we can hope for, and this gets to my third recommendation, is improving the procedures in the UK Parliament. I think it is important to note that whilst they're still rather deficient, they have improved somewhat recently. So at the final third reading stage of a bill, usually in the House of Lords, there is an express statement about legislative consent. So you at least have that acknowledgement that we are, you know, we're going to proceed without consent here. I mean, I've personally found the statements usually empty. So there's an expression of regret that we haven't managed to get consent, but no real articulation of why it's necessary to proceed without consent. So it's better, but it's not ideal. There are also on the UK Parliament bill pages, there are now links to the various legislative consent memorandums and motions, which again is an improvement, but a very slight one. House of Lords Constitution Committee has made some recent recommendations. Stephen can probably say more about these, about how you could improve scrutiny at the UK Parliament. They suggested a role for the Constitution Committee itself. And that would be, you know, that would be a way of forcing a justification, having an in-depth look at questions or disputes about consent. I don't think it wouldn't be a perfect mechanism, but at least it would be a process by which a body of practice, a body of commentary, a body of criticism could be developed. And then the last of my recommendations was doing something about secondary legislation on a consistent, and I said also mandatory basis. Again, very, very difficult to do, because we know in both this Parliament and the UK Parliament, when we try to regulate secondary legislative processes, they operate on an opt-in basis. It's difficult to mandate that a particular approach is taken across the board. And I think that actually is where conventions can be useful, because if you can't mandate in a in a legally binding sense, you could at least try to create an expectation of how things should work. So I would like to see agreed statements about the operation of devolved consent being extended to secondary legislation.
Thanks. Okay. Mr. Point.
Thanks very much. So I'll pick up on the question from Ms. Boyack about what can be done about this. First of all, I agree with your characterisation that the core problem, I think, in how this operates in Westminster is the lack of accountability for decisions taken by UK ministers about whether to proceed without consent in certain circumstances, or about sometimes failure to engage properly with the Scottish Government and the other devolved administrations during the process of developing the legislation, and also about the problem just referred to by Professor McCarger of whether or not consent is even required for a given piece of legislation, because there on that front, UK government can often just unilaterally determine, based on its own internal legal assessment, one assumes, whether or not consent should even be sought. I think those are the underlying problems. And then it's exacerbated by the fact that legislative consent really isn't visible in any meaningful way, as we've just heard, in the procedures and proceedings of the UK Parliament, with small exceptions, and there has been some improvement. So those were absolutely the problems we were trying to suggest solutions to in our report. And I don't, the proposals are summarised in the paper that you'll have seen. I won't go through them all in detail because there's quite a few, but the gist of them was there should be much more transparency about what the government, UK government, has done to engage with the devolved administrations to resolve disputes earlier, or avoid disputes actually earlier on in the process. And then in situations where there's a view that ministers want the UK Parliament to pass the legislation without consent, there should be much more transparency about that. And then the UK Parliament should take a decision explicitly on that basis, that yes, consent is required, no, consent has not been received for these reasons, but the bill should be passed anyway. That shouldn't be something that just sort of happens without people noticing, which is what I think has happened on some of these occasions. So I won't, as I said, read through all of these, obviously, but I think just a couple of specific things we'd be keen to see, and pleased that the House of Lords Constitution Committee has come to some similar conclusions. One key thing I really think is at the point of introduction of a bill, the UK minister and department responsible for that bill should lay something like a statement, a devolution statement, as we call it, that sets out in detail whether and why consent is required, what engagement has taken place, and whether there are outstanding areas of disagreement. That should, I think, be a kind of core part of the process. We'd then like to see proper select committee scrutiny of that, the devolution implications of each bill. House of Lords Constitution Committee probably would play that role on the Lords side. There's different options about how you might do it in the Commons. And then ideally there'd be reports back to the House earlier on in the process, rather than just that final third reading stage, so that, as I say, that the Parliament can proceed in full knowledge of whether or not consent has been given, and potentially there should be a dedicated extra stage of the legislative process at which
that would happen. That's something I know the Welsh Government has proposed as well. So those are kind of core aspects of what we would propose.
Thank you. Professor Tierney?
I would just say something briefly on the point that, Aileen expressed so well. I do serve as, I should declare, I do serve as legal advisor to the House of Lords Constitution Committee, but I speak in a personal capacity. It seems to me that in the passage of primary legislation, there's a lot that can be done to build in more stages for consent through the process. The LCMs are taken very early in the life of a UK bill, and there should be opportunities later on to amend legislation, as we saw in the Scotland Acts, and I think that's possible. One problem is that there's so much fast-tracking now with UK legislation, and this is a problem we're facing in the Constitution Committee of trying to deal with bills that are going through so quickly, and it's not just the coronavirus bill, you know, it's a lot of stuff. As far as secondary legislation goes, I think the 2018 European Union Withdrawal Act is a model of good practice. It's not best practice, but it's good practice. As you know, the initial plan had been to take all the powers back from Brussels and slowly disperse. There was a rebellion against that. And the principle now is that delegated legislation in devolved areas requires processes of attempt to get consent and definite consultation all the way through the process. In the end, there's a final step the UK can take. And what the Constitution Committee is now doing, bill after bill after bill, is recommending that that 2018 Act model is in every single bill where there's any attempt to reduce devolved competence or step into devolved competence by way of secondary legislation. It's entirely doable, and those wins are being achieved. They're not high profile, but they are being achieved. Could I say something about the normality point, Convener, because you asked me about that? It seems to me that attempts to define abnormality often come down to things like public emergency or national security. I don't think that's where the action is now. I think the abnormality we're talking about is Brexit. And what it is, it's filling the gap, the single market gap that has been left in the UK. And what the UK is doing through all of these bills, and it's not simply the withdrawal bills, it's all the bills that have come since, including the procurement bill, everything else that's going on at the moment, is attempting to fill an internal market for the UK in its various different ways. It seems to me that that's really essentially an issue of intergovernmental relations, and it raises all kinds of questions about whether SEWL is still fit for purpose. So other federal systems would say, well, this is areas where there's necessity measures going on, there's general welfare interests, there's the Commerce Clause in the US, and they would allow great licence to the centre to legislate for an internal market. The SEWL Convention doesn't allow that. Arguably, it's a good thing. But insofar as there are federal solutions to that problem, they all tend to be far more centralising, ironically, than the current system, in my view. One other thing about the Convention is that it stops dead at won't normally legislate without consent. What about the possible question of unreasonable withholding of consent? I just put that out there as something that has to be discussed. So in other federal systems, they would say, look, legislation on an internal market will tread into devolved or federal areas. It's inevitable. It's an inevitable consequence of overspill. We don't really have an allowance for that. We don't even have a preemption. So it's possible for the Scottish Parliament to come back later and re-legislate in the same area, unless that legislation overtly takes away the competence of the Scottish Parliament. What happens when one devolved assembly consents and another doesn't, as we saw in the EU Withdrawal Bill 2018? Arguably, that's just the way it goes. The Scottish Parliament still has the right to refuse consent. But it does raise that question about how SEWL begins to come under strain when there's not a united devolved voice in relation to UK legislation. So I'd be careful, I think, in arguing for legislative solutions to replace SEWL, because one might find that when we look at international precedents and international examples, they tend to be far more centralising in nature than the system that we have.
It's interesting. I'm going to bring in Mr. Golden. Thanks.
Thank you, Convener. It strikes me that Brexit could be categorised as not a normal event. COVID's not normal. Ukraine would be not normal. And therefore, legislation as a result of those not normal events that evolve involved devolved competencies would be in the not normal space. But nonetheless, as Professor McEwen pointed out, some legislation could be as a result of those not normal events, but encompass other parts that aren't required as a result of those events. And in addition, I think there becomes a point where if there's a series of not normal events, then does that become the normal? I hope not, but potentially. And we've heard some excellent ideas around disputed avoidance. I think governments, wherever they are in the world, are usually and often quite late in introducing legislation for a variety of reasons. But I'm interested to explore how we can put in a system that actually allows for dispute resolution almost out with the political sphere. So we've heard a lot about governments of devolved administrations and the UK government being involved in dispute resolution, but it strikes me that that often then involves a political space, and that is never a good place to resolve disputes. Is there perhaps a role for a new body that encompasses parliamentarians and its inter-parliamentary rather than just intergovernmental as a potential mechanism for resolving disputes?
Thank you. I'm just going to bring in Ms. Boyack, and then I'll open it to the floor. Mr. Clancy has already indicated he wants to come in.
Yeah, it's actually really helpful because Maurice has just triggered the point I was very keen to get a response from, because it's point six in the Institute for Government's recommendations, which I thought was a really interesting one, which is about dispute resolution. Maurice has just suggested interparliamentary, which would be one way of holding government account, and you've suggested an independent advisory panel established as a standing body to consider the competence issues in terms of disputes. So I'd be keen to get your view on it, and maybe also Michael Clancy, about different ways that you could do that. What are the pros and cons? Thank you, Convener.
OK, thank you. And I, from one point of view, I think I'm very interested in this area as well. Obviously, the Interparliamentary Forum has started up again, and those links are there, and I would say that the scrutiny of decision-making is a concern across all devolved parliaments at the moment, and for the House of Lords indeed as well. Their Constitution Committee has raised these issues. So it really is an interest in how we go forward with that, and as Maurice said, a formal Interparliamentary Forum is an informal grouping of the parliaments, and you know, I, as we move forward, you know, are we in danger of not formalising some of these in the, for future proofing for dispute resolution in other areas, and also in terms of common frameworks and how the parliaments can possibly scrutinise this at these points. So I want to bring in Mr. Clancy, and then I'll put up those points for the wider group. Thanks.
Thank you, Convener. The Intergovernmental Relations Annual Report talks about some aspects of consent to legislative consent motions, but it doesn't deal with anything in relation to subordinate legislation. And I think if the committee is going to be setting about making recommendations, then we should be looking at the intergovernmental relations matter. And we acknowledge that's taken a long time to get to where it is. On the interparliamentary aspect, I think that that's something which is extremely interesting. I recollect that Lord McFaul, before he became Lord Speaker, was very energetically trying to get the parliaments within the UK together to talk about matters of genuine importance for each of them, and that was in the throes of the Brexit legislative maelstrom. That is by far the best way to proceed is to have this interparliamentary forum, which is on an informal basis, and get to the point where we can have some kind of more formalised arrangement. And of course, that mirrors what is going on in terms of the interparliamentary partnership, which you dealt with as item one this morning, convener. If it's good enough for the TCA, it should be good enough for us. If we can use the model of the partnership as a springboard for being more more energetic about bringing parliaments together, and legislatures together in the UK, then that would be, I think, an unalloyed good. I'd better stop there because you've only got a few moments left. Thanks.
Mr. Pond, did you want to respond to Ms. Boyack's?
Oh, sure, yeah. So I think dispute avoidance and resolution is, yeah, this is absolutely a crucial area to try and improve in various ways. I think, so just one point to clarify, as others have said, I mean, there's two different types of potential disputes that we're talking about. So one is a question of whether or not a bill falls within the scope of the Sewell Convention, so where there's disagreement basically about that boundary between reserved and devolved matters. We know that on quite a number of occasions the UK government has asserted that this bill, in our view, does not require consent, so the whole issue of going through the consent process doesn't arise from their perspective. In that type of dispute, and then obviously there's disputes about proceeding without consent where it's accepted that Sewell is invoked. On the former type of dispute, ultimately that's a legal question, but it's not one that the courts can settle, as far as, you know, a UK bill can't be, of course, referred to the Supreme Court because we have parliamentary sovereignty and so on. So it's hard to, there's, you know, professors of law around the table who maybe can explain this better than I can. But, I mean, what we were suggesting in that sixth point is that, first of all, if you were to have a more formal process of scrutiny of the devolution and consent issues relating to legislation by the House of Lords Committee on the Lords side and perhaps a new devolution committee on the Commons side, perhaps, yeah, where this issue arose, we could set up either a new advisory panel or just have capacity for independent advice to be commissioned on that question of different assessments of where that boundary lies. So that's what we were suggesting there. On the other type of dispute where the UK government wants to proceed without consent, having accepted that the bill is within scope of Sewell, I do think the revised dispute resolution process in the Intergovernmental Relations Review is one, you know, way in which this can be addressed. There is scope for independent mediation, for example, that I don't think they've tested out those new processes, but this is one place that you could try and resolve such issues. And then I think also we don't have any sort of formalised systems of interparliamentary relations as you say, but I think, again, if committees in Westminster take this stuff more seriously during the passage of legislation, one thing that I would encourage them to do, and it is kind of in our report, is to engage with the relevant committees in the devolved legislatures, take evidence, oral or written or whatever, and ensure that those devolved views are fed in at the right point of the legislative process.
Yeah, we're bringing Professor McHugh and then Professor McCarkin.
On the Brexit is not normal thing, I think there's a useful distinction to be drawn between domestic legislation, which is implementing something already agreed internationally, and then I think there is more justification to proceed on a basis that that's not normal. I think, although Brexit in general is in many ways not normal, I think when it comes to reshaping the United Kingdom as a result of this major constitutional change, to do that without consent, I think, is a bit more problematic if what you're looking for is a longer-term sustainable situation. Really interesting suggestions on interparliamentary opportunities, because I think a lot of what we're talking about is deficiencies in the process at the Westminster end, and that's not really for this Parliament to determine. That's something the UK Parliament will have to think about. And some of the procedures that are appearing in more recent legislation that talks about consent in a different way, in a less meaningful way in many ways than Sewell, but does have some procedures set out there that could perhaps be useful in apply to a Sewell context. I'm thinking of the professional qualifications legislation, where there is a responsibility and an obligation, a duty to report on the consultation. So there's nothing like that when Sewell applies, but that might be useful to understand more what went on in the intergovernmental space and what is the nature of the justification for proceeding without consent. I think in terms of what this Parliament can do vis-a-vis the Scottish Government, I think it would be useful to know more about what happened at the pre-legislative end, because that's where I think some of the difficulties that emerge could be headed off if there is more pre-legislative engagement. So understanding a little bit more about that. I think in the IGR review, I think, offers opportunities. It offers opportunities to the devolved governments to use the new machinery where they have much more opportunity to do so now as rotating chairs and setting the agenda and so on, to get some of these issues onto the table, to use the new dispute resolution function if necessary, if there is a dispute, which would then help to get in sort of impartial expertise on some of these issues. Where the IGR review failed completely was in the transparency issues and in a role for Parliament. But that doesn't mean that Parliament has to accept that. So I think using interparliamentary channels will be much, much more effective if you're working collaboratively to make sure the issue of where Parliament comes in makes it onto the agenda, particularly of that middle tier interministerial standing group, which is looking at Sewell and issues surrounding it.
Just as an observation, it was interesting at the PPA, if they do decide to go down the route of subgroups, that will be likely to be around policy areas, and obviously, you know, subject committees of this Parliament have and the other devolved parliaments have no role in that, but the expertise would be there for devolved areas. So something that we need to be working on. Professor McCarg.
Thank you. I just wanted to pick up on the point about dispute resolution. There are in other systems precedents for parliamentary committees having a formal role in deciding on the constitutionality of legislation. So that it would be one route to go down. But I was also reminded in the UK context that there are precedents for seeking judicial advice on parliamentary matters. So there used to be, I don't know what the system is now, but there used to be a mechanism for the House of Lords Committee on Privileges to seek advisory rulings from the Judicial Committee of the House of Lords, so the most senior court, on matters which engaged its privileges. And there's a couple of really important decisions, for instance, about the status of the Scottish and the Irish Acts of Union as they pertain to the status of Scottish and Welsh, Scottish and Irish peers. So we do have, even in our own systems, mechanisms for seeking advice, not binding rulings, but advice, highly authoritative advice, on these kind of legal questions, which, for reasons of parliamentary privilege in that case, or parliamentary sovereignty in our case, cannot be subject to binding judicial resolution. So when I said earlier it's really difficult to resolve this problem. Actually, on further reflection, we do have some precedents that we might want to think about. Thank you.
Thank you. Professor Page.
Just following on from that, I wonder if I'm going back to our initial starting point, which was secondary legislation. I mean, I think one of the things I would want to stress is the need for much greater consistency in the framing of procedural requirements governing the exercise of ministerial powers to legislate in the devolved areas. What it seems to me we have at the moment is a confusing mess. There's no great surprise about that, but it needs to be sorted out. Are we talking about exclusive powers or concurrent powers? Are we talking about powers subject to consultation or not, as a matter of law or not? Are we talking about powers which are subject to consent or not, as a matter of law or not? So instead of just having a sort of pick and mix, choose what you want in relation to, you know, whatever piece of legislation it is you're promoting, I think there needs to be a model, an agreed model, which, you know, is the Sewell equivalent, if you like, in relation to subordinate lawmaking powers in the devolved areas. And I was intrigued by what Stephen said about the EU Withdrawal Act, if I understood him correctly, being regarded as a gold standard and an insistence now that this be replicated in other bills. Is that correct?
I didn't say it was a gold standard. I said it was a big improvement, and it did set a model for how you would attempt to arrive at consent in relation to the making of secondary powers.
Yeah. And is it being used?
Yeah, I mean, it's the standard approach to... If you are making secondary legislation in devolved areas, then the consent and consultation process is there. But having said that, you know, it is about consultation. In the end, it's something that the UK can do. Even if consent is not there. So, that's always the backstop on the Withdrawal Act.
But I think there's a need to go back into that area and just clean that legislation up, you know, once this has been resolved, and have an agreed way forward in relation to future enactments.
I'm very conscious of time. We only have a few minutes left. I don't have anyone else desperate to come in. Get out. Sorry, Mr. Clancy, I missed that. Thanks.
Thank you, Convener. Just quickly, on that point of subordinate legislation, of course, it is true that there's no provision for consent for subordinate legislation, but subordinate legislation has to be in accordance with the vires of its parent act. It is at the point where the parent act is being enacted that is where we have to focus our attention to make sure that the powers loaned by Parliament to ministers are proper and can be exercised in a way in which it satisfies everyone. It's that one step back from dealing with subordinate legislation.
Thank you. I think we've exhausted time this morning, if not our questions and interest in this area. But I just wanted to say, and echo Ms. Boyack's comments, a thank you to everyone for the submissions to the committee, which is extremely helpful, and to Professor Dr. McCorkindale for his continued support and for the sessions. As I said, it's a series of roundtables that we're having in this area. And I'm sure the committee will be reporting on it at some point in the near future. So a thank you to everyone for attendance this morning. And on that note, I'm going to close this committee session.